Thank you, Jonathan, and thanks to our audience, the Asia Society, for all being here tonight at this wonderful event. I also want to introduce Eugene Suen, who will be interpreting tonight. We worked before. He's a wonderful interpreter and also a film director and producer of his own right. So you just saw this incredible film, Ash Is the Purest White, in Chinese, Jianghuarnu, which is a strange term for those who, if you speak Chinese or you don't speak Chinese, Jianghu literally means the world of the lakes and the rivers, which it refers to this kind of martial arts world where a lot of works written in the wuxia tradition or the martial arts tradition take place. And this literal title, Jianghuarnu, the sons and daughters of the land of the river and lake. So I want to just start by asking the master, Mr. Jia, what does this term Jianghu mean to him and what brought him to this film?
就是片名《江湖儿女》，这个片名本身就是非常传奇的，这是我们马上想到武侠的电影，想说这么一个场景。那你能不能先介绍一下何为江湖片？那什么是江湖？你为什么当初决定要拍这样的一个影片？这个可能大家刚才看电影也看到，那个电影里面的江湖都翻成了汉语拼音。 因为那个我们的字幕翻译跟我说，英文里找不到一个词是可以对应的。那对我来说，我觉得江湖它首先意味着是那种四海为家，这个在这个飘摇移动的生活里面，这个寻找生活可能性的人。我觉得这是一个广义的一个概念。那么当然在那个在中文里面，江湖 也有它特质的，比如说地下社会江这个江湖人物啊，就是根植那种地下社会的人。So
it's also, if you just watched the movie, you notice that even the subtitles, the Chinese titles, 江湖儿女, you notice that even in the spelling, the phonetic spelling of the Chinese subtitles, it's spelled out 江湖, because my the person with the subtitles telling me that there's really no proper English word that could properly really convey the idea of Jianghu, because that is a tricky word to convey. So in terms of the broad meaning, for me, Jianghu really denotes this idea of this nomadic, wandering lifestyle, and that's something that is very known and familiar to Chinese culture. So this idea of people who kind of wander, who lead this nomadic life, and who look for possibilities outside of their own confines, who are just kind of wandering the earth, looking for new possibilities of life. So that is, for me, in my mind, the broad definition, the broad meaning of Jianghu. But specifically, it also often refers to this notion of the underworld, this underground society, or underworld, underground characters. That's kind of this more specific connotation.
我第一次看到江湖儿女这个词是，去采访这个《40年代中国著名的导演这个费穆的《小城之春》的女主叫韦蕾女士。韦蕾女士回忆说，费穆导演晚年准备拍的最后一个电影的名字就叫《江湖儿女》，我一下子非常喜欢这个名字，因为江湖就是在经典的中国人的人际关系里面，江湖是 用情感，用义气，用情义来连接的。那么，所谓江湖儿女，江湖里面的人，之所以我们中国的文学、中国的电影一直在表现，就是因为在这个传统的古典的江湖的这个哲学逻辑里面，人和人之间是用情来连接的。所以，他们都是一些充满了深情厚谊这样的一个人。那我很喜欢这个词，但对我来说，我 我感受更多的是江湖的变化，是这种经典的人际关系在时代的巨大的变革中怎么一点一点的瓦解，甚至消失。So
when I first came across the title of the film Jianghuarnu, the sons and daughters or the children of Jianghu, I first came across it when I was interviewing the actress Wei Wei, who was a very well-regarded, very well-known actress in Chinese cinema in the 1940s. She had done movies with a legendary Chinese director, Fei Mu, the director of Spring, Small Town. So basically, Jianghuarnu, the sons and daughters of Jianghu, it was to be the title for Fei Mu's last film. That was the planned title for his last feature film, but he never got to do that. So when I first heard this from I had a strong response to this title. It really was inspiring to me. So for me, this idea of jianghu, in traditional classic Chinese culture, it denotes this notion of emotional ties and bonds between people, whether that be the ties of loyalty, of righteousness, of love. People basically, they relate to each other relationally. It's very much revolves around the notion of love and justice and so on. And this is also something that's been widely depicted in Chinese literature, movies. It is a fundamental part of the classic Chinese philosophical principles. So for me, this was a really kind of interesting idea. But beyond that, I was interested looking at how jianghu, how this notion has changed and evolved and transformed over the course of time, the passage of time, and how in the process of change and transformation, this notion, these values of righteousness and love and justice and loyalty, they start going to decline and even to the point of disappearance.
And many years ago, one of your first early great masterpieces was a film called Platform, which was a kind of epic that spanned more than a decade. And it began in the Reform era, and it went up to right after June 4th, 1989. This film also has a similar long canvas, and I was wondering if you could describe why you chose this particular period from 2001 until 2018. Is there a similar kind of moment that you wanted to really capture?
1989到2018年的天文时间结束了，这一部也是时间跨度非常大。那是不是也有一些具体的时间点影响，主要是为什么2001年开始，一直到了2018年结束？迄今为止，我拍过三部影片是有比较长的时间跨度的。第一部就是我的第二部影片《站台》，一部影片是从1978、79年拍到了这个90年代初。 也就是说，整整80年代这10年的一个故事，因为当时在写那个剧本时候，那时候是90年代中，我在读电影学院，然后有一种那个年代已经是这个消逝的感觉，那是让一个孩子成长过程中最兴奋的10年，因为他也是。
So since the beginning of my career until now, I've done three feature films that all take place over a wide span of time. So the first film was my second feature, Platform. So in that movie, the time span I covered, it was roughly from the late 70s, 1978, 79, to the beginning, to the early 90s. So it is really a story about what happens in the 1980s. It is a story of the 80s. When I first conceived of the idea and was working on the screenplay, it was around the time of the mid-90s. So I was writing it in Film Academy when I was still a student, and this was already the mid-90s, so to me, the 80s was a decade that had already disappeared. But it's also an exciting decade. It is the decade of my youth. I was basically 10, from the age of 10 to 20. You know, that's the span that the 80s covered. So for me, it's always been, in my imagination, an important and exciting time.
那《江湖儿女》这部影片的故事的起点是2001年。 之所以把它选择在2001年，是我觉得中国社会加速度发展的一个开始。因为那一年，就是中国申办奥运会成功，然后也加入了 WTO， 然后也这个移动这个手提电话开始这个普遍的进入到。 这个生活里面，也包括互联网开始出现，那么随之而来的，就是在当我们当时站在一个新世纪的一个入口的时候，我们只是感觉到了这个社会在急剧的变化，但是它会给我们带来什么？我觉得充满了好奇跟兴奋。那么十几年过去了，再次这个凝望那个起点的时候，我觉得我非常想拍一部电影。 能够像一个时空的漫游一样回到过去的年代，甚至回到我过去拍过的那些地方，山西、三峡，来重新结构一个故事，来看这个时代变迁里面我们这个。 内在的变化吧。
And in this movie, Ash Is Purest White, the starting point is 2001. And the reason why I decided to set the beginning of the film is the year 2001 is because in my mind, that's the beginning of an era in contemporary China. It's the beginning of a period that saw unprecedented, very rapid social transformation and societal changes. 2001 was the year when China, basically, they were approved to be the host country, the host nation for the Olympics. That was the year when China officially joined the WTO, the World Trade Organization. And that was also the year when, basically, that's the era when internet, cell phone, these technology became part of people's day-to-day life. So all of a sudden, you have all these changes that are happening that are unprecedented. And at this juncture, at this beginning of the millennium, in this situation, people had this very... They started to wonder what's going to happen in the future. They had a sense of curiosity and excitement about what the future holds. But now, you know, 17 years later, now that looking back when I was working on the film presented me with an opportunity to review what had happened since then. In the years since 2001, it gave me a chance to review not only what had happened in Chinese society over the course of this time, but it's also an opportunity for me to review my own films, as it were, because in my prior films, I had gone to places like the Three Gorges Dam, I had covered Shanxi, so this is also a way for me to review both Chinese culture, Chinese society, what's happened since, but also my own filmography.
因为我觉得在我十几年前的作品《三峡好男人》里面，那是06年的作品，在那个作品里面，比较多的是中国这个社会一眼可以捕捉到的变化，比如说这个因为巨大的三峡工程，好几个3000多年历史的城市被拆迁变成废墟，最后淹没，有上百万的人的移民，这些都是很直观的，我们能够很容易捕捉到的这些变化，对个人的影响。 最近几年，我觉得可能就是更加让我动容的是，逐渐感觉到了人内在的变化，情感世界的变化。就像我刚才说的，可能过去我们不仅仅是所谓江湖，而是整个中国社会都有一种传统的经典的人际关系的这种处理的方法，重情重义，但是随着这个时间的推移，它 逐渐的淡了，在重新调整人际关系的时候，可能更多的考虑的是金钱啊、利益啊，就是这样的一个内在的变化是让我非常的不平静。然后我觉得确实就好像电影里面的用的叶倩文的那首老歌，它是一首老歌，那个声音就好像一个已经要逝去的声音一样，当然也不是荡然无存。我觉得像 乔乔这样的人，可能他还是把一部分过去世界珍贵的东西带到了当代。
So in my 2006 feature, Still Alive, which takes place in the Three Gorges area, on that film, I was able to capture a very visible, noticeable changes that were happening right in front of me, because this was a place that had 3,000 years of history, and all of a sudden, overnight, because of the project, the dam that were being built, the project that were happening in that area, all of a sudden, you know, this area that has 3,000 years of history became submerged, and millions of people had to migrate as a result of what was happening. So these changes were very direct, was very noticeable, it was easy to capture on film, and also to capture how this kind of drastic societal changes affect individuals. But then later on, as I began to work on a film like this, I became interested in the gradual changes of society, especially as the way it relates to the changes in people's inner life. So it's no longer just societal, what's going on outside, but it's also what's going on in the inner interior world of the people, the characters. Because as I was mentioning earlier, you know, these notions, these classic Chinese principles and ideals and philosophy having to do with loyalty, justice, love, and so on, as society changes gradually, you start to see that instead of these things, these traditional values, classical values, they started to give away to things like money, profits. So this kind of changes that I observed, it really unsettled me. And this is also the reason why in the film I featured the song by Sally Yip from the 1980s, because that song for me represents a way of life that might be disappearing. It's not completely gone yet, but it's gradually going to decline and disappearing. But nonetheless, you have figures, you have characters, and people like Chow in this movie, the female protagonist, she still holds on to things that are important, that are dear.
So I want to talk a little bit about the actors in this film. And of course, the two leads are really incredible, Liao Fan and your wife, Zhang Pao. But before I hear you talk about that, there's something very unique about this film in terms of the casting, and that is, there are some directors like Hitchcock who make cameos in their own films. Jaws made a few cameos in his own films. But this is quite unique because if you look carefully, some of China's most famous directors are all in this film supporting roles. So you have Feng Xiaogang, Xu Zheng, Diao Yinan, Zhang Yibai. You know, that's almost half a dozen of, you know, this is like having Spielberg, Scorsese, Polanski all appearing as actors in a film. And so I want to ask you why. How did that come about, and what did you hope to do through this gesture? And it's just such a unique approach to film. So,
我想这个片子非常特殊的一点就是你请了父母就是几位大牌导演来这样的这场戏，用徐江、用冯小刚、张一白啊等等，过去你的片子是也有像世界，也有像帅，也有张一白，能不能谈谈是什么样的一个动机让你请这些导演来在片子里接这些戏？这个剧本写完之后，包括在写的过程中，我就觉得出场人物非常多，因为除了男女主角之外，其实所谓江湖就是他们男女主角他们。 所经历的不同的人，那就是他需要很多演员来演，然后我自己在写的过程中，经常就某一个人物，写出来之后，就会想到是由谁来演，有的是由我们跟我合作过的演员，有的是我的一些朋友，包括我的导演朋友，因为这个就是他们出场都非常少，非常短。 他们需要有一个非常鲜明的气质和特点，然后我觉得我的这些导演朋友特别的鲜明，然后像这个，因为我写那个刚出狱的那个叫大学生嘛，我马上想到就刁亦男，因为他瘦瘦高高的，戴一个眼镜儿，很斯文的样子，然后就是我觉得我记得拍完这个张一白的时候，他。 又跟我讲的说，我明白了，赵涛跟廖凡演的是儿女，我们这一群人帮你演江湖，江湖里需要人吧。So
for me, it was actually doing the process of screenwriting, and so writing, because this is a movie about Jianghu, this underworld, with a lot of different figures and characters, so even as I was writing, you know, these ideas would occur to me. It would occur to me. I would start to have ideas about who to cast and who to put in movies, these different people, because it's important to have a large ensemble, large cast of people to reflect the world of Jianghu. So some of the people I cast in this movie are actors I had previously collaborated with. Some are friends of mine, and many of whom, as Michael pointed out, many of whom are director friends of mine. Because these people, their appearances in the movie are brief, they're short, but I really want their appearance to be able to register to the viewer. They have to have this very vibrant and charismatic presence. So that's why I decided to cast these directors. So for example, someone like Diao Yinan in the film, you know, plays someone who just recently left prison and is young and so on, is because he has that very kind of bookish vibe that I thought was appropriate for the character. It was also funny to me because Zhang Yibai, who was the other director that was cast in the movie, he was saying that, oh, I see what you're doing. You cast the main actors as Ernie, the sons and daughters, and you cast us as Jianghu, as you know, the underworld figure.
但是某种程度上，我是觉得，我的这些导演同行可能他们更加的能够理解我的剧本，因为拍电影的人也是江湖中人，我们也是四海为家。 然后几十个兄弟就出去拍电影了，什么都能遇上，然后我觉得就是他们对于剧本就会有更直接的一种体验，就跟我总觉得拍电影确实也是闯江湖。
And another important point is that for these directors, they really understood my script and what I was trying to do, because in my mind, in a way, filmmakers are like these jungle characters, because we are all, in a way, wanderers and nomads. When we make a movie, you know, there's a bunch of us, 40 plus, for example, we would just go out and make things happen. And it's as though we're big, a family of brothers, people who are tied in some way that is very direct. So I feel like these directors, they can very immediately understood the kind of the sort of spirit I'm trying to capture. They can very directly understand this jungle idea, because in my mind, filmmakers are like jungle characters.
So I've got a lot more questions, but I know you guys have a lot of questions, and there's some really incredible ones that already filtered up to me. And it looks like there's some sci-fi fans in the audience, because there's multiple questions here about UFOs. wanting to know the relationship between the UFO and the movie, and where did the idea for the UFO come from, and what symbolic meaning does it have? And of course, I think this is going to also take us back to one of Jia's earlier films, Still Life, about a decade earlier. And so,
我们观众里头应该有一些科幻粉丝吧，因为有好几个问题是问关于这个飞碟UFO的关系，一个是片里的UFO是从何出来的构想，是有什么样的一个含义，UFO与电影的关系是什么，另外我想回答这个问题的过程当中，也许会涉及到那个十年前拍的《三峡好人》有一些感觉UFO的关系。嗯，对，我两部片子都出现过UFO，一部是十年前的。 十几年前了吧，都对，这个《三峡好人》，06年的《三峡好人》里出现了UFO，但那个时候我是因为我第一次去三峡，然后去到了巫山凤节这两个古老的县城，然后那时候他们的老城都已经拆迁接近尾声，然后我去了之后被那儿的超现实的气氛所一下子所震撼。 因为县城都拆得差不多了，都变成了废墟，然后你看整个那个废墟的感觉，我第一印象就好像不真实，特别像这个外星人来过，地球遭受了外星打击或者核战争的这个遗留物，然后确实那个时候就觉得中国这种加速度的变化，它有一种魔幻性在里面。 那我自己捕捉这种感觉，我觉得既然现实里面有这样的一种超现实的氛围，就开始有了这个楼会飞走啊，UFO飞来的这样的一些这个想象出现在剧本里。
So two of my features have featured UFO. So the first one was Still Alive in 2006. And the reason for including the motif or the symbols of UFO at the time was because when I first went to this area to make the movie, I was visiting the area, the cities of Fengjian and Wushan. And at the time, these were really old, ancient cities that had suddenly, overnight, gone into ruin because you know, these ancient cities were being torn down and put away. So as I was there, even though this is real life, this whole environment, this whole area had a very surreal quality about it, because a lot of things are simply gone and have been torn down overnight and looked unreal, as though aliens had come by and visited, and there had been wars and shooting, battles, whatever, from some extracurricular extraterrestrial activities had taken place. So for me, the UFO motif became a way for me to reflect on the rapid changes that was happening in China at the time, where you see things that are so surreal, even though it's happening in real life, I felt like this was an appropriate way to capture the surreal in the real.
那么到《江湖儿女》的时候，就写到这个巧巧这个人物，他离开三峡一个人，这个去了新疆，然后在新疆的时候，就是在拍之前我去看景的时候，我跟 这个新疆这个当地的制片说希望能够找到一个这个能看到星星的地方，能看到银河的地方，然后这个我们那个制片说我们这儿哪儿都有银河。And
then on the Ash Is Purest White, so we see the character Chow, after the section with the Three Gorges, she goes to kind of the Xinjiang region alone by herself. And when I first went out there for location scout, I was talking to my local producer. So first I was talking to my local producer, telling him that I hope to find a place where you can see stars and galaxies very clearly. And at the time, his first response to me was, you can see that anywhere, everywhere in this area.
那果然开车离开那个城市大概十分钟就是一片，就抬头看就是繁星满天，这个在城市里是看不到的，在北京我好像很久没有看到过星星了。 然后站在那个夜空下看着星星，我就觉得突然感觉我像一个桥桥，然后我觉得前面都是经历，都是人际关系，她跟男朋友的关系，她跟这个父亲的关系，她跟兄弟们的关系，然后她一路上遇到的那些麻烦，就是她一直在跟人打交道，唯独站在夜空下，站在新疆的夜空下是她一个人，然后我觉得可能应该是女主角最孤独的时候。
So sure enough, after I talked to the producer, sure enough, we basically drove out, drove beyond the urban area. So even just 10 minutes outside of the city, when you looked up, I just saw lots and lots of stars. Stars just fill up the sky. And this is something that you just don't see very often, especially in Beijing. I felt like I hadn't seen that in a while. And at that time, when I was looking at the stars in the sky, I really felt like I was like the character, Chow, in the movie. Because at this point, she's totally alone and by herself. And also in the context of the film, by this point in the story, she had gone through a lot in life, gone through a lot of challenges, and had to deal with all kinds of people, whether it's boyfriend, her father, the brothers in the underworld. There was a lot of troubles and hardship that she had gone through. And finally, we reached a point where she's now utterly alone and by herself. This is the most alone she had ever been. And it occurred to me that it would be nice to have a UFO appear at this moment and say hi and send a greetings to her, as it were.
There's also several questions here about your choice of having a female protagonist. On the one hand, using a female point of view to navigate these evolving relationships in China. There's also a question about how Jianghu, if we started our conversation with, is traditionally a world of men. If you think of Shui Wu Zhang, all men are brothers, or the Water Margin, it's all male characters. So what made you choose to have a female character be our tour guide through this world?
就是有好几个关于女性的问题，一个是你为什么选一个女性的视角来探索当代中国的非常复杂的人际关系，另外一个是所谓传统的江湖都是男人的世界，我上过水浒传都是108的好汉，那为什么选一个女性的角色来带我们进入这么一个江湖世界？我是不知不觉写成这样的。
My first response is just something that came about almost unconsciously. So at first, I thought the characters, you know, the female protagonist, male protagonist, at first, when I was writing the script, I thought they were the same kind of people. I thought they were fundamentally the same. But then it, later on, as it evolved, I realized that the trajectory would actually instead be the man, the male protagonist, he would go from a place of power and strength, and over the course of the film, end up in a place of weakness and decline. And the woman, conversely, would actually go from a place of relative weakness to a place of strength and power.
Yeah, 我觉得是很少的，就是可能是第一次在写剧本的时候，不知不觉中有一种对作为男性导演对男性有一种反思。我们讲江湖的情谊，有时候我们会发现，那些大哥一直在说情谊其实是说给小弟或者小妹听的，是说给他们相信的，自己不一定相信。但是他周围的小妹小弟，像巧巧这样的人就相信了，变成他们的信仰。 我觉得男性在这样的一个社会里面，可能他们就是我们迷失的更厉害，因为主流价值都是逐渐的变成是就是金钱、权力，然后对情感的重视、对自我的忠诚。 往往就随波逐流了。女性在生活中，
For me, I think in a way, you know, I suppose you could say that this movie is a way for me as a male director to reflect on the notion of male identity, especially in terms of, you know, the values I was referring to earlier on, these classical Chinese values of love, loyalty, righteousness among the underworld figures. A lot of these ideals, they're really kind of just things that, you know, the big brothers, the senior figures in the underworld, it's thought that they say to their underlings, to the younger brothers, to the younger folks in that world. So it's not something that they themselves really take very seriously. It's just something that they would say. But instead, oftentimes these ideals, they get passed down to their underlings. So a person like Chao, the female protagonist, she really very firmly and sincerely believed in these values. So consequently, this allowed me a chance to examine how these values over the course of societal changes, how they gave away to things like money and power, and mainstream values start to, these traditional ideals and values start to go into decline, and this people like Chao that actually still hold on to them.
对，但女性我们会发现，就是她们对情感更加的注意力更加的这个投注于更大的注意力，然后对自我更加的坚持吧，我觉得跟我这次写剧本不知不觉有一种反思有关。
So instead, it's really the female characters. I think they're more attentive or put more stronger emphasis on the ideal of bonds, of relationship, of affection, and these things that are really a matter of self integrity and self respect. It is really the females that hold on to these values and ideals.
So I think we're short on time, but I want to end with one final audience question, and that is, what's your advice for a first-time director?
So before, this is a question that have been asked me many times about younger filmmakers, and I was really bad at getting a response to this kind of question. But then 2 years ago, when I started organizing the Pingyang International Film Festival in China, I invited Johnny To, the Hong Kong director, to come and give talks to the students. And at the time, I thought what he said was excellent. It's just wonderful, the advice that he offered. So right now, here and now, I will just basically convey and pass on the message that I received, that I heard from Johnny Tong to all of you. So his idea was really passion and a sense of perspective, opening up, widening the horizon. These are the two things that Johnny Tong put strong emphasis on.
So with that, I want to thank Jonathan Clark and the Asia Society for hosting us, the wonderful Eugene Suen, our interpreter, and really one of the greatest living filmmakers, the wonderful, masterful Jia Zhangke. Thank you.